Hello, this is to welcome. Hello, everybody. This is Shastri, Chairman, Technical Board. It's a privilege.
Sir, good morning. Commander Rajan Babu, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Sir, Admiral will be coming now, sir. The Admiral.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome back to Gujarati. Thank you. Thank you for taking time and addressing our students.
Pleasure. Pleasure is mine. I will take out this because I'm the only one here, so I can take this liberty.
Yeah. So I will also take out, but we are only some four people are there. Four of us are in this hall. So shall we begin? Shall we begin?
Yes. Yes, please. Yes, please.
So, yeah. So now I will hand it over to Professor Shastri, and he will introduce, and then you know he will coordinate the program.
Okay.
On behalf of technical board, as a chairman technical board, it's a privilege to have Vice Admiral Dinesh Tripathi sir, who is an serving DG Naval Operations. He's an alumnus from NDA Khadakwasla and joined the Navy in 1985 as an expert in communication and electronic warfare specialist. Under him, he has commanded INS Vinash, INS Krich, and INS Trishul as an operational duty, and also held several staff appointments, including fleet operation officers of the Western Fleet, Director of Naval Operations, Principal Director Network Centric Operations, Principal Director Naval Plans, and also Assistant Chief of Naval Staff at the headquarters. Apart from his dedicated duty, he has a keen interest in international relations, military history, art and science of leadership. Vice Admiral Dinesh Tripathi sir is a recipient of Ati Vishishta Seva Medal and Nav Seva Medal for his devotions. Coming back to today's topic of the talk, Vice Admiral Dinesh Tripathi sir will be covering a wide range of topics, starting from India as a maritime nation, the history of it, the importance of maritime nation security in the current context, that will bring in the role of premier institutes like IITs and IITG in particular in deciding the trajectory of the technically inclined Navy. There would also be an outline on the requirement of Indian Navy and discuss potential avenues where institutes like IITs can contribute their bit in terms of innovation and excellence. And taking things forward, he will also talk about Indian Navy as a way of life and its efforts in training and grooming students who can be transformed into future leaders. With these few words, I hand over to our director, Professor Sitaramji, to kindly initiate the proceedings.
Same.
Sir, Shashi sir, your mic is
it's same. No, it's same key. Good afternoon. Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, welcomes Vice Admiral Dinesh K. Tripathi, AVSM, NM, Director General Naval Operations, for accepting our invitation and delivering a live lecture commemorating the United Nations Universal Children's Day on this day. Sir, World Children's Day was first established in 1954 as a Universal Children's Day and is celebrated on 20th of November each year to promote international togetherness, awareness among children worldwide and improving children's welfare. November 20th is an important day, as it is the date in 1959 when the United Nations General Assembly adopted the Declaration of the Rights of the Child. It is also the date in 1989 when the United Nations General Assembly adopted the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Since 1990, World Children's Day also marks the anniversary of the date that the UN General Assembly adopted both the Declaration and Convention on Children's Rights. Mothers and fathers, teachers and nurses, doctors, government leaders, and civil society activists,
religious and community elders, corporate moguls and media professionals, as well as young people and children themselves, can play an important part in making World Children's Day relevant for these societies and communities and nations. World Children's Day offers each of us an inspirational entry point to advocate, promote, and celebrate the children's rights, translating into dialogues and actions that will build a better world for children. Today, Vice Admiral Dinesh K. Tripathi, AVSM-NM Director General Naval Operation, is going to talk on shaping the future leadership, a step towards nation building. Thank you very much, sir. We're very happy to have you with us today. And I hope, you know, this will be a great talk for all of our students, and even any faculty as well will be hearing you. And I'm sure the topic you're going to talk on, technical inclination, leadership aspects and all, will benefit a lot to our students and faculty. With these few words, again, warmly welcome you to this event, and we would request you to address the gathering. And thank you one and all for making this program a possible. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Namaskar. Jai.
Thank you, Professor Sitaram, for giving us an insight into the World Children's Day. Thank you, Professor Sastri, for introducing me to the audience. It is my pleasure to be here this afternoon. Professor Sitaram, Director, faculty members, students of Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to you all from here in Delhi to wherever you are netted in. It is an absolute honor and personal privilege for me to interact with you today on the occasion of the World Children's Day. I am indeed grateful to Professor Sitaram for inviting me to share my thoughts with such a bright and vibrant audience. I am especially happy that the participants are largely from the millennial and net generations, who are future leaders, citizens, and decision makers of our country, and will handle the challenges of tomorrow in various disciplines. I can assure the students in the audience that you are in perfectly safe hands of your highly committed and professional faculty, who will facilitate your transition from what you are today to what you can become tomorrow. It is wonderful to know that 22 faculty members and researchers of IIT Guwahati recently figured in Stanford University's list of world's top 2% scientists. A huge honor. I would like to specially congratulate the director, Professor Sitaram, and his faculty members for this well-deserved recognition for their research and lifetime contribution. Now, I have previously had the pleasure to interact with Professor Sitaram when he had visited the Indian Naval Academy at Azimala, Kerala, as chief guest for the convocation ceremony for the BTech passing out course in November of last year. We had also discussed our experiences in shaping future leaders, and we had realized the criticality of technology and the so-called knowledge warriors, which is what you all students are. Of course, a lot has changed during the past year, as the COVID-19 pandemic has affected the entire world in all walks of life. Literally, from the way we breathe, what we eat, where we travel, and how do we do our work. In that sense, it has been a tough last 10 months for all of humanity. I can only say that we have no option but to remain positive and resilient in these unprecedented times and believe that this shall also pass and the world will return to the pre-COVID normal. In a lighter way, the COVID has affected my travel. I was looking forward to travel to Guwahati and interact with you in person. But I am sure the director will be kind enough to invite me again at earliest opportunity whenever it is feasible. Thank you. Having said that, let me start by giving you an outline of my talk today, which Professor Sastry has already elucidated. I intend to bring to your notice the maritime character of our country, which many, and I would say most countrymen, are unaware, with no fault of theirs. I will also highlight the challenges in the maritime domain and our dependence on the seas for trade, energy, and food security. I will also share with you the role of Indian Navy, which is the principal arm of the Government of India for ensuring maritime security of our nation. I will then lead to a topic dear to me and highly important for all the students, which is the art and science of leadership. I will conclude by giving you some tips based on my experiences over the last 35 years in white uniform that may stand you in good stead as you navigate your professional and personal lives in the years ahead. Now, most of you must be aware that 70%, in fact, over 70% of our planet is covered with water. Incidentally, that is the same amount when a new baby is born. That is the amount of water a baby carries, almost 70%+. The two largest water bodies in the planet, so to say, are the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans. The Indian Ocean, which is of utmost interest to our country, covers 20% of the world's oceanic surface. Nearly 40 national nations border the Indian Ocean, which constitutes 1/3 of the world's population. Further, 50% of all global shipping and 70% of all oil transits through the Indian Ocean. At any given time, there are an average of 12 to 13,000 ships operating within the Indian Ocean region, from the Red Sea and Persian Gulf in the west to the Bay of Bengal in the east and stretching up to the Antarctic region to the south. Although smaller than the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans, experts believe that the 21st century will be more about the Indian Ocean than either of these two big brothers. It is also said that how the geopolitics of Indian Ocean unfolds will be a crucial factor for the overall trends of 21st century geopolitics. And we can see some trends even as we speak. You would also appreciate that traditionally, the Army and the Air Forces operate in a well-defined environment where land borders and air zones are mostly delineated. This simplifies identification of what is and what is not a threat. Oceans, by nature, are unowned, uncontrolled, and unregulated. High seas beyond the limits of exclusive economic zones of nations, that is traditionally up to 200 nautical miles, approximately 360 kilometers from the coastline, are not owned by any one state. These high seas afford free movement to all and are termed as global commons. You must have heard of this, global commons, which provides freedom of navigation to all vessels, including to those owned by nations which may not even have a coast. The seas and oceans are therefore highly congested and contested environments with no clearly demarcated boundaries. That is why nations create and maintain navies, which are highly technologically intensive and financially demanding. Navies are meant to operate wherever the national and maritime interests of the country demand. Large navies like the Indian Navy, therefore, need to have the capability to operate for long durations away from our shores and base ports, extending for months on, which requires intrinsic or organic capability in terms of reach and sustenance, as also availability of facilities and bases for support. Navies facilitate a maritime virtuous cycle that reinforces maritime prosperity through maritime power. Ladies and gentlemen, India was, India is, and India will always be a maritime nation. The sea and the coastline have been an integral part of our mythology and history. We have an ancient maritime tradition dating back to the Indus Valley civilization, and Harappan engineers built the world's first tidal dock at Lothal in Gujarat 4,500 years ago. Excavations have also led archaeologists to believe that there were sea trade links of the Indus Valley civilization with the Greco-Roman empires and with Mesopotamia. Before colonization set us back, Indian kingdoms were dominant thalassocracies, that is, kingdoms built on maritime dominance. And our subcontinent was also a thriving sea trade hub. Today, as we take steady steps towards reacquiring our rightful place in the world order, our national leadership has rightly understood that to be secure on land, we must be supreme at sea. It is therefore important not only for the uniformed people like me, but also for future leaders, our next generation, that is you students, to understand the nuances of the vast maritime domain, its implications for the well-being of our people, and its unique sets of challenges and opportunities. With this historical background in mind, it is important for all of us to realize that the maritime nature of our nation is integral to our national identity and is firmly entrenched in our national ethos from time immemorial. It has been said that our country lies in the very lap of the Indian Ocean. I think it's the only ocean which is named after a country. Our history, our geography, our economy, our position and interactions in a globalized world, our nation's development and security are all intimately and intricately connected to the maritime domain. Let there be no doubt. Our country is indeed blessed with a coastal line of more than 7,500 kilometers and over 1,300 islands. Our international trade is also largely dependent on the medium of the seas. Over 68% by value and 95% by volume of our foreign trade is seaborne. Around 82% of our oil needs are also imported across the seas, and another 11% is met from our offshore assets. To put it in perspective, if the import of oil through the seas is stopped or affected for any reason, our petrol pumps will run dry very quickly. Our exclusive economic zone, which measures nearly 2 million square kilometers, provides us with a treasure of marine wealth and resources. Our fishing vessels, which number in hundreds of thousands and sustain our significant coastal population, stretch all along the coast from Gulf of Kutch in Gujarat to West Bengal and from Lakshadweep to the Andaman Nicobar Islands. The seas around us and the oceans touching them are therefore of great importance to the development of our country and, most importantly, to to the security of our coast. In a nutshell, our country's maritime heritage and moorings, which make India a maritime nation, also makes the Navy key to the security of our nation. Having been in the Navy for my entire adult life, it is obvious that I should give you an insight on the Navy's roles, responsibilities, and contribution towards our nation. We are proud to be not only contributing to national security, but also in nation building. The Indian Navy is the world's fifth largest Navy, and we are growing every single day. It is a well-balanced three-dimensional force consisting of sophisticated missile-capable warships, aircraft carriers, advanced submarines, latest aircraft, and state-of-the-art infrastructure to support these platforms. Now, most of these warships are of indigenous design and have been constructed in Indian shipyards. For maintenance and upkeep of such a large inventory of ships, submarines, and aircraft, we have modern maintenance facilities manned by a specialized workforce. At present, we have two major operational bases at Mumbai and Visakhapatnam, training establishments at various locations being controlled from Kochi, and one tri-services joint command at Port Blair. All these are networked to ensure peak performance of our Navy at all times. And you will be glad to know that we are now recognized in the Indian Ocean region as the preferred security partner and first responder to any emergent situations. So how does the Indian Navy help in nation building? Firstly, the Indian Navy is responsible for the safety and security of India's maritime interests. Operating with other stakeholders in the ministries and various other agencies, the Navy ensures and enables maritime security in the maritime zones of India and beyond, establishing an environment conducive for the unhindered conduct of trade, shipping, fishing, offshore exploration, and other maritime interests that are vital for economic growth and national development. This fulfills a constitutional mandate of ensuring the socio-economic prosperity of our citizens. Secondly, the Navy continuously ensures security and stability in the region. There is today a renewed focus of the world on the seas, driven principally by the immense geo-economic and geostrategic importance of the maritime domain. One of our major tasks is security of energy, which complements the nation's efforts for energy security and is provided round the clock along our sea lines of communications. The waters of the Indian Ocean and Indo-Pacific region have also emerged as the main arena for geostrategic competition. It's all there in open domain. I'm sure all of you are reading it. Now, these waters and their littorals are critical to the world, both economically and politically. However, in recent times, we have witnessed extremely assertive moves by some aspiring powers to expand their influence in the region. These actions have undermined security of the region, resulting in widespread concerns among the international community. The Indian Navy has therefore resolved to work to enhance the security and stability of the region in concert with like-minded and friendly foreign countries without compromising on our strategic autonomy. Whilst India does not believe in alliances, we believe in creating convergence of ideas to be able to work together. Thirdly, the Navy provides assistance for contingencies at home and abroad by providing humanitarian assistance and disaster relief, HADR in short, and aid to civil authority, aiding UN peacekeeping missions, including the World Food Programme and non-combat evacuation operations. Recently, we provided assistance during the floods in Kerala, both last year and this year, and during the COVID pandemic through Operation Samudra Setu and Mission Sagar. In short, you name an event of significance in the maritime domain and you will find Indian Navy's presence, whether for shaping the maritime environment or during the action itself, we are there. Fourthly, the Navy facilitates growth of economy, our economy. How? Self-reliance and indigenization, and now Atmanirbhar Bharat, as very rightly enunciated by our Honorable Prime Minister, have always been foundational aspects of our force development plans. As we speak, over 40 ships and submarines are being built for the Indian Navy in Indian shipyards. Over the past decades, we have been able to transform ourselves from a buyer's navy to a builder's navy. Some people say shipbuilding and nation building are synonymous. And the Indian Navy is committed to ensuring that indigenous shipbuilding delivers dividends both technologically and economically through the downstream and multiplier effects. In empirical terms, every rupee spent on shipbuilding has a 1.8 times multiple effect downstream. And every person employed at a shipyard generates jobs for 6 persons in other supporting industries. Lastly, the Navy is a key enabler of our foreign policy. As we aim to shape a favorable and positive regional environment for enhancing net security in our areas of interest, the Indian Navy is the prime agency in the implementation of the government's foreign policy initiative of Sagar, or security and growth for all in the region. The Indian Ocean Maritime Nations expect India to take on a large leadership role and devote more resources to prioritize connectivity in our immediate neighborhood, whilst also expanding the interpretation of what constitutes India's neighborhood. As I stated earlier, the Indian Navy is seen and believed to be the preferred security partner in the region, and we are committed to share our capacities and capabilities with like-minded maritime nations on their request. Well, what I've spoken so far is the larger view of our roles and aim. Since I'm addressing the combined intellect of IIT Guwahati, I must give you a brief about the technical inclination of our Navy. This would be my attempt. I'm not a technical officer, I'm a journalist, but this would be my attempt to spread awareness while trying to tickle your probable fields of interest. The Indian Navy is progressing various projects using the latest technologies such as artificial intelligence and applied machine learning in multiple domains, ranging from autonomous vessels, drones, swarms, predictive maintenance, prescriptive analytics, cybersecurity, data management, etc. And we are determined to maintain our technological edge. In 2019, the Indian Navy also established centers of excellence in big data, data analytics, and 5G. And we are on the verge of restructuring our internal organizations to seamlessly absorb all these emerging technologies. The Navy's focus on state-of-the-art multidimensional networks for both operations in the terrestrial, underwater, wireless, and space medium has also ensured a reliable network-centric environment. Inputs from multiple sensors are seamlessly fused into a common operating picture, providing us with maritime domain awareness, which is a key result area within the Navy. Now, the Navy is also undergoing a major digital transformation and bringing in best practices from the IT industry into its fold on fast track. There is renewed impetus on cloud computing, DevOps, NetOps, We have established state-of-the-art IT infrastructure designed to enhance future operations, efficient administration, and timely logistics in order to ensure high morale of all level personnel. We are also the lead service to implement a fully digital, smart, and a secure identity system for our armed forces. The Navy also provides a great opportunity for students who wish to operate at the enterprise IT level and function within a modern-day computing environment. Our focus on state-of-the-art weapon systems and kinetic warfare technologies will also provide adequate challenges and opportunities to those who choose the Navy as a career or who would like to develop technologies for our Navy. You will be happy to know, students, that the Navy has already inducted cutting-edge technologies in the field of active electronically scanned array radars, medium-range surface-to-air missiles for anti-missile defense, and long-range supersonic anti-ship and land attack missiles launched from ships, submarines, and aircraft for offensive operations. Unmanned aerial vehicles for maritime surveillance, space-based sensors for maritime domain awareness, network combat management systems, and high-speed data links for enabling network-centric operations, network of networks aggregating a variety of terrestrial, satellite, and radio frequency-based mobile ad hoc networks, what we you guys call MANET, comprising software-defined radios, are some more technologies that the Navy is pursuing. We also have the unique distinction of successfully running a full-fledged in-house research and development agency, namely the Weapons and Systems Engineering Establishment, or WESI, here at Delhi. Now, as we work together for a better India, the role played by knowledge warriors, irrespective of them being in uniform or in civil clothing, is extremely crucial. Safeguarding our country from cyber attacks is one such field. A technology-driven India is the need of the hour, and each step taken towards this is highly welcome. This is where the tech-savvy generations of today can contribute. We understand the nature of technology and innovation, and therefore we have set up our own innovation organization, which can interact with bright innovators like you and create unique technological solutions for the nation. Ladies and gentlemen, you will be transitioning from a student to a professional in the coming years. And of the many professional avenues available to you, one of the most exciting and adventurous would be the naval way of life. The Indian Navy offers a challenging and rewarding career for young, adventurous men and women who seek to don the white uniform and become officers and leaders of men. In fact, the Navy is not just another job or a career, it is unarguably a way of life. As a naval officer, you will have the unique privilege of being a member of a highly motivated and professional force, acquiring higher academic qualifications and assuming important responsibilities. The Navy operates in a technology-intensive environment. I have already illustrated what all we are doing, which provides adequate avenues for the technically inclined to contribute towards innovation and excellence. There are many branches and cadres in the Navy for which you could volunteer, from executive to like me, to technical, logistics to medical, and pilots to submariners, to serve in a multidimensional force centered on influencing and controlling the seas around us for nation building. However, by no means is the Navy all work and no play. Please don't get despondent. Perhaps only a few other professions can match the glamour of the white uniform and the pride of wearing it. In the Navy, camaraderie and kinship is strong. One works shoulder to shoulder with teammates and learns to appreciate the importance of commitment, credibility, compassion, and integrity. I underwent the formative years of my professional life at the National Defense Academy in early 1980s. And I have spent over 20 years cumulative time at sea in various capacities, ranging from a young officer on board a destroyer up to my last sea appointment of commanding the Eastern Fleet, which had more than two dozen combat ships. Now, during the last 35 years of my service in the Navy and 3 years at National Defense Academy, for that, I have been exposed to various types of leaders, both military and civil, and to their leadership styles. I was always intrigued with learning about what made some men and women successful leaders. So when I was deputed to undergo a year-long course at the Naval War College at Newport, Rhode Island in USA, about a dozen years back, I enrolled into their leadership capsule as an elective subject. That capsule gave me an immense insight into leaders and leadership. And in fact, I did author a paper on the effect of culture on leadership, which was highly appreciated and, more importantly, was a satisfying experience for me. So what is leadership? Can anyone amongst the students define leadership? Or what is your understanding of this term? I'm not sure whether we can interact on the VC. So let me give you my understanding, ladies and gentlemen. There is no single definition of leadership. Although a very simple definition states, and I quote, leadership is the art of motivating a group of people to act towards achieving a common goal. I repeat, leadership is the art of motivating a group of people to act towards achieving a common goal. Every word of this simple definition has a meaning. And in your time, I will request you, recommend that you have a look at it. And I'm sure most of you are already leaders in your own domain, but you can connect the dots. General Colin Powell, I'm sure some of you must have heard, all those who followed the First Desert War, post-1990, he was a former four-star general in the U.S. Army and later the Secretary of State of the United States of America. And he is one of my favorite contemporary leaders. I have read his biography, I have read his autobiography, I have read his hagiography, and I have followed his quotes. And I have, of course, seen what he did in the Desert War. And he opined that, and I quote, leadership is the art of accomplishing more than the science of management says is possible. I go back again. I want to repeat this. Leadership is the art of accomplishing more than the science of management says is possible. Now, please be aware that leadership and management operate at different levels, but both are complementary. And in today's day and age, my belief is that both are required for a leader to be successful. Someone has also succinctly put this, and I do agree, that management, while management is about persuading people to do things they do not want to do, leadership is about inspiring people to do things they never thought they could do. The very subtle difference. Again, I repeat, because it is a VC. So, you know, if I'm garbled, then you can get it correctly. Management is about persuading people to do things they do not want to do. Whilst leadership is about inspiring people to do things they never thought they could. It is also said, and I do believe, that leadership is practiced from heart. It's all about here. It's all about your guts. It's all about your instincts. It's what you feel. It's all about empathy. You don't scheme leadership. You don't plot leadership. You don't think about leadership. It is there. Because you practice what you preach. Whilst managers think from their mind, which is also important. So like I said, both are complementary. But if we have to look at leadership only, you have to have a large heart and you have to use that heart. Now my generation, some of the students must be thinking that must be many decades ago. Yes, that is true. Now my generation has seen many changes unfold in front of us. We have not heard of internet, no mobile phone, nothing of that nature. If you had to make a call, you have to book a trunk call. Today's generation will not understand what is a trunk call. When I say trunk call, they will go start looking at a tree. When I was getting married, when I was dating my wife, if I had to make a call, I had to walk to a place 2 kilometers, 5 kilometers from my ship, wait there for 1 hour, then I get my call and I have to talk to her on a trunk line. Things have changed for better. So we have changed, seen many changes, you know, our generation. Now, amongst many changes, the most important things that has transformed our lives, the way we think, the way we train, and then in the military, the way we fight, is technology. Growth in technology, when we compare to what was available when I joined the service, when I got commissioned in 1985, and what is available now, where we have just witnessed the cracking of quantum computing, has been nothing less than phenomenal. And we are a lucky generation. I consider myself a lucky generation. We have seen what has happened in the last 30, 35 years. Today, technology is the ultimate disruptor. And it is not only in negative sense, even more, it is more in positive sense. It is changing the status quo. It is inspiring people to think. We saw a program called Star Wars. We heard of Ronald Reagan's Strategic Defense Initiative in 1980s. And many Americans, not us, many Americans thought this guy is mad. Today, just few days back, you must have read that an intercontinental ballistic missile was shot down by a missile borne launched from a ship. In 1980s, when I was a lieutenant, young officer in the Navy, I could never think. I thought this guy is talking through his head. Just because America has got a lot of money, they're talking this Strategic Defense Initiative, and of course, Star Wars was a TV program. Such advent has not only altered the requirements to be a well-informed and a capable leader, but also requires us to inculcate high-end technology in every facet of our professional life. And I don't think anybody can prepare the student better than IIT Guwahati. Technological advancements in augmenting situational awareness by all available means is therefore a must for today's leaders to take well-informed decisions. And this also contributes towards the risk appetite capability of a leader. A leader, a good leader, must have the large-heartedness and the mental capacity to take risk. It's a cliche to say, no risk, no gain. But that set aside, a leader must have the appetite to take risk. And that can only happen if he has all the wherewithal with it. There is very thin line between risk and gamble. Risk is well-informed. Gamble is like, you know, playing teen patti. Very, in a very crude way. towards the larger aim of supporting a combat-ready, capable, and cohesive Navy. I come back to Navy again. It therefore becomes incumbent upon us, and also, I would say, a prestigious institution such as IIT Guwahati, to make every effort towards training and grooming students for transformation into future leaders in or out of uniform. The challenges and demands on a student of such an institution perhaps seem different. Presently, you must be worried about pressures of learning, pressures of performing, pressures of passing an exam, pressures of getting good grades, pressures of getting picked up by somebody who's coming to your university, pressures of giving some other exam. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Pressures of looking at greener pastures, etc., etc. Nothing wrong with anything of those. All is fair. The aim of any education is to facilitate acquisition of knowledge by students, which helps them later in their lives. If the education and knowledge part has been imparted well, it is more than likely that with experience and expertise that comes later in life, the so-called wisdom may also be achieved early and relatively easy. Because the ultimate aim of any education is to get wisdom. So I have laid out a PERT chart for you as to how you can achieve the wisdom. Some people achieve wisdom early, regretively, some may never achieve. But knowledge and education is the bedrock of that. Now I come to an interesting facet called control the controllables. I always believe in the dictum of controlling the controllables and doing our best in our respective sphere of influence, because that is in our control and we can do what needs to be done. For a student or a scholar, both are very clear. Control the controllables and do our best in their sphere of influence. And therefore, it is not too difficult to comply with. And yet, statistics tells us that not every student performs and demonstrates focus and diligence that is required or expected from him by the institution. Why does that happen? I would like to narrate a few tips for the students that could help them to improve themselves personally as also professionally. Here I mean performance in subjects and in your respective field of interest. Now I call them the ABCD of studentship, which perhaps applies to all of us as we remain students throughout our lives, and that is the way it should be. Firstly, A for attitude and aptitude. I think these two words are the basic building blocks of a student's life. Whilst attitude refers to behavior, both physical and mental, aptitude is linked to talent or intellect and is therefore largely a mental attribute. One can also talk about positive and negative attitudes, which are self-explanatory. And you will agree with me, there's no place in our lives for the latter, that is negative attitude. Aptitude can also be worked upon through hard work, through single-minded focus, through copious reading, through good education, and through assimilation of knowledge. It is all within control the controllables. It is all within your sphere of influence. Secondly, B, believe in yourself. Believe in yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, self-belief and confidence are energy and performance boosters in an individual. These enable people to dream big and never give up, whatever may be the situation. Mental strength and conditioning is a prerequisite for this to be developed. Here I would like to highlight that the present should not limit your future. I would specially advise students that the social and financial condition of your parents and guardians today only indicates your present and the start of your journey. It does not limit your potential future or destination, as these are fully dependent upon you and your capability to work with focus to realize your dreams. Thirdly, C for commitment and character. Now, commitment is all pervasive and is applicable in all walks of life throughout the professional and personal life of an individual. But it is very important for a student. This also implies trust, diligence, single-minded focus, and dedication. One has to take responsibility and give time for various activities and requirements of a student's life. There are no shortcuts and absolutely no free lunches in life. Only hard work, diligence, and remaining committed to the task at hand can guarantee success. They say character is what you do when no one is watching you, because everybody behaves well when somebody is watching you. Character is the bedrock of discipline and is closely linked with your beliefs and values. That brings me to the fourth one, the D. D for discipline. Discipline, and especially self-discipline, brings stability, which enables more focus and cuts out distractions. This calls for sacrifices in terms of desires and pleasures, and making hard choices almost on a regular basis. My belief is that without self-discipline, one cannot achieve the level of success and satisfaction commensurate with the efforts, hard work, or talent possessed by an individual. It should therefore be the endeavor of every student to improve himself or herself every day, both as a person as also as a future citizen and leader. Now, having spent your formative years as per the ABCD, I have just stated, the most basic and important facet of your preparation towards becoming an effective leader is working hard and giving your best. That should not cease, ever. I am sure you must have heard this directive from your parents, from your teachers, throughout your growing years, and today also, and you will hear it tomorrow also. What it means is that you should be ready to put in your long hours. We also call it colloquially, it's called slogging, and be single-minded in finishing or achieving what you have set out to do. Obviously, you will have to sacrifice much in terms of your desires and pleasures, as I told earlier, but you will have to do what you think is required at that point and not do what others expect you to do. Don't come under peer pressure and other pressures. Remember, please, the difference between ordinary and extraordinary is that extra. So be prepared to walk the extra yard if you want to transcend yourself from ordinary to extraordinary. You have to do more than others if you want to excel. Vince Lombardi, an American footballer, not soccer player, American football is played a little differently. You can use both hands and legs. He was a coach who was also a successful motivational speaker later. In my view, you had correctly stated that perfection is not attainable. But if we chase perfection, we can catch excellence. And that should be our aim. My belief is that while working hard, you have to enjoy what you're doing. Because if you don't enjoy, you're perhaps not doing it well enough. And if that is the case, then you need to review and recalibrate your methods and tools and start enjoying what you're doing. Automatically, you will start doing it well. Self-belief, ladies and gentlemen, is a force multiplier. We use this term force multiplier regularly in the military domain. And it motivates you to stay the course and not quit when things don't go your way. Philosophically speaking, if at any point of time of your journey, if things are not looking good, you can be sure that it is not yet the end. In a lighter vein, just remember the famous Bollywood dialogue, quote, "Picture abhi baaki hai mere dost," unquote. Here I would like to recite a few lines from a poem titled "Don't Quit" by John Greenleaf Whittier, which I am sure some of you must have read, and I quote, "When things go wrong, as they sometimes will, when the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when the funds are low and the debts are high, and you want to smile but you have to sigh, when care is pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't you quit." And it goes on, at the end it says, "Success is failure turned inside out, the silver tint of the clouds of doubt, and you never can tell how close you are. It may be near when it seems so far. So stick to the fight when you are hardest hit. It's when things seem worst that you must not quit." Unquote. Please read it again and again, again and again. I read it once a week. It gives me more motivation. Now you will in many ways decide the trajectory that India will take in decades to come. As I said, you are the future. This is going to be an exciting journey for you. And you will have abundant opportunities across diverse fields and professions as per your choosing. However, these opportunities will also be accompanied by responsibilities and challenges. My aim today was to dwell upon some of those most significant responsibilities that your generation will shoulder, which is the responsibility of the youth for nation building. For me, the youth of our nation has immense potential, and we should be proud in being a young country. I would like to quote our Honorable Prime Minister when he says, and I quote, "The foundations of the 21st century rest on three critical pillars of teamwork, innovation, and technology. These three pillars also form the foundation of your quest for nation building. Teamwork is the key to finding solutions to common challenges. As you step out of this prestigious institute tomorrow means not tomorrow, but at some point of time, you will soon be leading and managing a team which will look up to you for answers. I will re-emphasize the leadership will remain a significant part of your lives as well, irrespective of the line of employment that you choose. Four qualities specially required for leadership within a team are personal example, that is, you walk the talk, courage, there's some people say courage is grace under pressure, professionalism, and vision. Always remember the adage, there is no limit to what you can achieve if you don't care who gets the credit. And that is the theme of teamwork. Your vision will help you undertake future leadership roles for our nation and become the drivers of nation building, contributing to our great country's prosperity and ensuring its unhindered growth. You may face innumerable challenges along the way. In fact, you will face, no, who has not faced? In whichever profession you may choose. But the leadership qualities that I have highlighted, and there are many more, may help you in overcoming some of those. The last few minutes, ladies and gentlemen, I have listed some of the salient traits and desired qualities in a leader. Of course, there are others such as punctuality, financial probity, and compassion or empathy for your team members that will go a long way in making you an effective leader. Furthermore, the demands on you as a leader will keep changing as you climb the ladder of success, and you will be required to tweak your leadership style to suit the new responsibility. And here I would like to quote Marshall Goldsmith, one of my favorite authors, leader, motivator, guru, and he says, "What got you here may not get you there." This is a good book. I would recommend all of you to kindly lay your hands on and read it. Now, with so many varied options, I'm sure that all of you will certainly make an effort towards taking a wise decision for your future and also continue to work towards a nation building. I keep repeating nation building. I would like to conclude by suggesting to you not to worry about what your critics say. Believe in yourself, in your capabilities, and you will achieve what you have set out for. I hope to see each one of you doing well in your chosen profession and making our country proud. I would recommend that all of you must truly enjoy your life and, of course, also remain focused on immediate task on hand. The director is looking at me. They have to read first what they're supposed to do here. I wish all of you a pleasant stay at IIT Guwahati and a bright future in whichever domain you choose. Of course, if you are selected for a career in armed forces, please be ready for leadership roles very early in your lives. I wish you and your families a very prosperous festive season ahead and all the best in your future endeavors. I also once again congratulate the director, faculty and staff for their excellent work towards making IIT Guwahati a premier educational institute whose reputation is formidable not only in India but across the globe. Last but not the least, I wish you remain safe and take all precautions, and please adhere to promulgated protocols during the ongoing pandemic. Remain positive and maintain a happy lifestyle, always believing that this too shall pass. I wish you all good luck and healthy year ahead. Jai Hind and God bless. Thank you very much for your patient hearing, and thank you once again, the director, Professor Sitaram, for inviting me for interacting. I couldn't see the students, but they fully trusted me. I'm yes. Questions, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. It was a very, very inspiring, powerful, innovative speech. I think you covered all the aspects of India as a maritime nation, Indian Navy as a way of life, and also your technical inclination, being the head of the school, and also they gave a very good advice on leadership aspects. Let me tell you, it was a very fantastic, particularly you said the leader should work from heart, and the difference between a leader and a manager, you made it very clear and very obvious to everyone. I think it was a very useful lecture. Now I will hand over to Professor Shastri. Before that, I would like to thank you for taking this time off, even though you have busy schedule. And address. Yes, thank you very much. So have a great day, Professor Shastri.
Thank you, sir. And being a technical institute, as you must be aware, we are getting the standard queries. The basic query is because armed forces or space programs are so shielded, how can a student approach, or what is the line of approach if somebody is interested to do internships there or they want some guidance? Because our students keep developing nice fancy gadgets and they want to showcase to the people, and we always get stuck in the bureaucracy about lacking how to approach. So if somebody wants to approach a Navy for some guidance or for some demonstrations, students want to know how one should approach the R&D cell for any further guidance or demonstrations.
Thank you very much, Professor Shastri. Very apt question. I have heard this from many quarters. You know, firstly, we have got an Indian Navy website. It is open for anyone to get into it. There is a trove of information there. And the site is actually multi-layered. So you could keep clicking, clicking, and you will come to a place where you will find your area of interest. We have the authorities and organizations which specifically look into this issue of anybody who wants to integrate with us, work with us in the field of technology. At the naval headquarters itself, where I'm sitting now, we have a full branch, so to say, which we call material branch, which we deal with technology. But technology is so pervasive now in the naval operations and naval way of life that all of us, irrespective of whether you are technical entry or not, have to understand technology. Like, I am Director General of Naval Operations. I have the whole of Navy's communication under me. And you know, the developments, technological development which have happened in the field of communications. So I have no choice but to understand the basics at least. Of course, there are specialists who deal with it. But I don't see any reason why, if any of the students want to reach the Indian Navy per se, aerospace part separately, ISRO part separately, there are different mechanisms. But to reach the Indian Navy, certainly it's not very difficult. Anybody who cannot reach, kindly approach me. We will facilitate. We'll ensure that the correct authority answers those queries. So Director General Naval Operations is your start point. But I'm sure in the Indian Navy website, you'll find answers there.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And one more interesting question that I received is, can a student do an internship in Navy on the sea?
We don't have this internship program per se. We have various types of entries for, of course, officers and other than officers. So there is no internship per se as of now. You can certainly our students go to IITs, serving officers like us, lieutenants, lieutenant commanders, they do go. So that is one medium where the people in uniform and those not in uniform, they interact and they're doing sterling work. But I have no doubt that if you really want to contribute towards Navy's technological build-up, or you want to give your ideas, we are open and we get these requests day in and day out, and it is facilitated. We hear them, we call them, take presentations, we discuss, and then we take that to next level. We have all education institutions have signed memorandum of understandings with a large number of these civil institutions, including IITs. So, in fact, the director and I have discussed, there is a need for us to sign MOU between my last job as the commandant of Indian Naval Academy and IIT Guwahati, because Indian Naval Academy is also a technical institute. It is running a 4 years BTech course. So, certainly, there is a possibility for interaction, but there is no internship. The closest to internship is there's something called a short service commission entry, which is wherein the interested personnel can become officers for 10 years to start with. And after 10 years, if they feel that they have had their naval career, they are satisfied, they can branch out to the civil world. So that is the opportunity which is right now.
Thank you, sir. And the other question, the general perception is that to get into any armed forces, NDA is the entry point, which is after plus two. But if somebody graduates from an IIT and wants to contribute to the armed forces, They are asking what is could be the entry level for them.
Yeah, like I said, the Indian Naval Academy, Azimala, Kerala, your director was there. Unfortunately, came only for one day. It is a place to go and stay there, enjoy the beauty of that place. It is one of the best military training institutions, I would say, certainly in Asia, arguably in the world. It is running a four-year BTEC course. Now, all those people who have done already done their BTEC from outside, they can also join the Indian Naval Academy. So there is a scheme for them to join the Indian Naval Academy. They can join both for permanent commission and short service commission. And serve. And there have been cases, many cases, where people from IIT Chennai have joined and now they are serving in the Navy, they are serving in the Army, and similarly, I'm sure, the Air Force. So avenues are available. It is exactly up to you, the students, what you want to do. But our doors are open. And of course, there is an exam, and there will be a medical test, etc. But those are my... Welcome to INA, all those who are coming.
Yeah, thank you. I have one question to you, sir. So we have actually received this time a very big project on technology incubation hub on underwater robotics.
Oh,
almost
wow.
100 underwater robotics. This is about 135 crore project. So I think, you know, you should now, I know that you have moved out of Indian Naval Academy, Izumila. So please connect us back. Who is the head there? So that, you know, we can revive our MOU and start sending our students to Indian Naval Academy. That is one thing, because now it may be easier for you because you are in Delhi now. So you can give instructions to them. So you are in the headquarters. So we request you to help IIT Guwahati and our students to visit Indian Naval Academy, Izumila, which is, as you rightly said, that's a very easier to do. And you have there also the ship and small, you know, other activities where they can, our students can involve. Thank you. I will seek your response on this.
There is no problem at all. The visit of IIT Guwahati students to INA can be arranged. There is absolutely no problem. But I'm more interested in this, your project which you are doing, which may be interest to here in Delhi. And we'll talk mutually, not on this open circuit. We'll you and I will talk separately on this. This is underwater,
sure.
Remotely. What are you doing? Yeah. Will be interesting. Yeah. Okay.
We will connect you. We are also starting a master's program.
Okay.
In this, and PhD program also from this next year, from July 2021.
Congrats.
Yeah, this is a very unique program wherein we are going to train large number of industry participants in this, actually.
That's very good to know. Thank you. So we'll connect with you certainly, and we will take it from here in a bilateral.
Mr. Shastri, you can come. I think those were the basic questions which were answered. So I take this opportunity once again to thank Vice Admiral Dinesh Tripathi sir for taking his time out and addressing our students and the faculties, and looking forward to take the work what you have said forward to our student community, and I hope they are inspired enough to join the services. I thank you once again, sir.
Thank you, Namaskar.
Thank you very much for inviting me once again. Good luck and God bless.
Sir. Yeah, we will be in touch. I'll call you sometime.
Okay, thank you.